Hello everyone. In the previous videos on the lesson Introduction to Biotechnology, we learned about plant tissues, we learned about animal tissues, and in this video, we will be learning about tissue culture. What is biotechnology? Techniques of bringing about improvements in living organisms by artificial genetic changes and by hybridization for the welfare of human beings are together called biotechnology. So we use technology, use certain techniques like genetic changes and hybridization for the welfare or for the good of human beings, and this is called biotechnology. Now the two main techniques used in this science are genetic engineering and tissue culture. The uses of biotechnology are for cash crops, increase in ability of plants to withstand stresses from the environment, vaccine production, early diagnosis of congenital diseases, organ transplant, cancer research, production of artificial skin, artificial cartilage, etc. in laboratories. So you can see so many new kind of things and so many areas in which biotechnology helps us. One being the early diagnosis of congenital diseases. Now these diseases are medical conditions that are present at birth or even before birth. So if they are diagnosed early, it is good for people. Artificial skin and vaccine production. So from you can see from this picture here, okay, implantation, see the imaging of that burnt or wounded skin. A computer is used, okay, we come to know what kind of skin texture and what kind of skin the person has. At the same time, you collect the skin cells, culture it, you know, use different solutions. Then you bioprint or, you know, make the similar type of skin that is got from the person, then this bioprinted skin is matured and finally we can transplant it or implant it on the body of the patient who requires it. Similarly with vaccine production, there are lots of procedures that they follow in biotechnology. Tissue culture. Ex vivo growth, that is growth outside of the body of cells or tissue in an aseptic and nutrient-rich medium, is called tissue culture. Now, this is the definition. Ex vivo growth meaning growth outside the body, not within the body. Growth of cells or growth of tissue in an aseptic. Aseptic means without any germs. And a nutrient-rich medium means they provide the nutrients for this tissue to grow. A complete organism can be developed from a single cell or from tissue with this tissue culture technique. Okay, so you can see here, one single cell can make an entire plant. And this is not by putting seeds into the ground, but by taking either cells or tissues and growing them in a laboratory. A liquid, solid or gel-like medium prepared from agar supplies nutrients and the energy necessary for tissue culture. Now, agar is a gelatinous substance. It is got from seaweeds, red seaweeds, and used in biological culture as a thickener in foods. Biological culture means, you know, a petri dish is taken, tissues or cells from whatever plant we want to grow are taken, and you know, and it is put in a medium, you know, a little gel-like medium, which is prepared using agar. And what is this agar? It is a substance got from red seaweeds and it supplies nutrients to these cells or these tissues and allows it to grow in a, you know, germ-free environment. And finally, when that cell grows, it grows, tissue grows, and we can get an entire plant. Processes in tissue culture. Okay, now these are, this is one of the processes, like you see the apple tree, you know, the apical buds, the new leaves which are grown are taken, This is the petri dish, you know, maybe in an agar medium, gel-like medium, and this is how it starts growing. Okay, when it starts growing from stage to stage here in a test tube, after 18 days you will find at this kind of temperature, 25 to 40 degrees Celsius, they regulate the temperature, and then you find this is grown. After this you will get, you know, so many different kinds of different plants growing from little cells, and then you get virus free plants and an entire tree. Now from small apical buds you can grow so many apple trees using the process of tissue culture. Similarly, from your textbook you see the source plant banana, okay, then you get a small part of it, then here see the treatment taking place, you will find reproduction and multiplication here, then shoots and roots are formed, they take it out and put it like this, okay, and then you have so many plants growing, and each of these plants give you a new tree. So this is how tissue culture helps. Stages in agricultural management due to biotechnology. Genetically modified crops or GM crops are produced by changing the DNA of natural crops. These varieties are not found naturally, but they are produced artificially in a laboratory, and they are called GM or genetically modified crops, where the DNA, you know, DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid, is changed or altered. Okay, so we have some GM crops here like corn, okay, and BT cotton, which is grown artificially. Now, unlike naturally growing crops, GM crops withstand great stresses from the environment, like the weather, which is frequently changing, hot, cold, rainy, whatever, wet and dry famines. Now, famines are conditions where there is no food absolutely. So it could be due to floods, it could be due to no rain, the changing climate, etc. So these GM crops, they are able to withstand these stresses. Normal crops will go away, they will perish, they will die if there are these extreme changes in environment, but not GM crops. GM crops are also resistant to insects, pests, pathogens, those are germs, chemical weedicides, etc. Hence, if there are GM crops, they are already resistant to all these things, so we don't need to use harmful chemicals. Okay, weedicides are chemicals used to kill weeds, but since the GM crops are already resistant to weeds and pests, we don't need to use these harmful chemicals. Using seeds of GM crops increases the nutritive value of the crop and decreases the loss of crops. So obviously farmers will want to use these GM crops, which have high nutritive value, they are good for eating, as well as there is less chance of the crops being destroyed. So these are some of the top 10 genetically modified fruits, and you can see corn, cotton, papaya, rice, tomatoes, potatoes, dairy products, and most of the things that we require in for having a nutritive balanced diet. Farmers are cultivating GM crops on a large scale, and the area under GM crop cultivation is increasing day by day. Like we have MON 810, which is the corn grown genetically modified, golden rice. Okay, pest resistant genes have been introduced in some crops. These are the transgenic potatoes, and you have your genetically grown tomatoes, also soya, which is genetically grown. In this manner, a green evolution is being achieved in India, which has a huge population, so that there is food for everyone. Now in nurseries, Okay, nurseries are used for very various purposes, like growing gardens on a large scale, for restoring the forest, that is afforestation and reforestation. So for these things, seedlings or small little plants have to be supplied in large numbers. So it is profitable in these nurseries. Nurseries are places where you get all the small little plants so that you can take it home and grow it, or you can take it in the garden and grow it. Okay, so this is done not by putting seeds and wasting time, but by tissue culture techniques. Okay, tissue culture can be used to grow plants on a large scale which bear flowers and fruits of excellent quality. So this is how tissue culture is done. You know, you take a small piece of a tissue of a plant that you want to grow and put it in an agar-rich medium. You know, after some time you will see the roots and shoots of them coming up. You have to take it and separate it, and you get a huge number of plants. Now, fully grown plants can be produced in this manner using tissue culture in very short time. Application of biotechnology in floriculture, that is with flowers. Okay, now plants can be grown on a large scale even without the processes of pollination. That is the pollination meaning, you know, the insects taking the honey from one and then carrying the pollen grains from one flower to another. Nothing is required when you use tissue culture. We don't need to put seeds and wait for it to germinate. No? And this is used especially in the production of orchids or the, this is orchid, or the pitcher plant. Okay, so you will see here how it starts growing, and there are many plants. We separate the plants, put it into the soil. In forestry, how does biotechnology help us? In a bioreactor, cells can be grown in a more nutritive medium and protected from pathogens or from germs. Now, bioreactors produce plantlets on a very large scale. Now, this is a small bioreactor. You know, it is a tissue is taken, or cells are taken, put in a gel-like medium, and many, many plantlets grow in this bioreactor. So, they are then, when they are ready, when the roots and the shoots come, they take them out, they plant them into small, small, you know, small plastic containers, okay? And they can be used to put wherever they are wanted. Okay, now these kind of things are called bioreactors. Now, why do we use a bioreactor? Because a large number of seedlings can be produced in a short time using minimum resources and materials. No need for the farmer to go out there, put the seeds, water it, and wait and wait and wait. Okay, here he is already getting plantlets or small little seedlings which are produced in the bioreactor. Okay, so see how many can be made, and individually then you can grow these plants. Plants produced by tissue culture and genetic modification are disease free. Plantlets produced by tissue culture of the meristem are virus free. So why wouldn't someone want to have virus-free, disease-free, and have less tension about your plant getting destroyed? Embryos formed by normal hybridization may not develop fully, but embryos produced by tissue culture always complete their growth. So now, the meaning of this is, now if I want to have a plant which is having, you know, the qualities of two different plants, so I hybridize, or I put them to fertilize together. Now, sometimes when natural hybridization is done, this plant may not develop fully. But if tissue culture is used, you know, then we are able to get whichever quality or whatever plant we want, and the plant will also develop fully. So, tissue culture is much better than the normal type of growth. Rare and endangered plants can be grown by tissue culture technique, and they can be saved. Okay, so when we know that something rare, something is going to be endangered, something is going to become extinct, we can slowly take out the tissues or the cells and start growing it in the laboratory, and therefore they are saved, and we can save them from being extinct. We now come to another concept of biotechnology, which is agri-tourism. Now, if sufficient land is available, plantlets or small plants of flowering plants, medicinal plants, ornamental vegetable plants and fruit trees can be produced on a large scale by tissue culture. So, very nice, fully self-sufficient agro-tourism center can be developed. Okay. Now, what is the meaning of this? The meaning of this is that, you know, we have spice gardens and we have botanical gardens. So if there's enough land available, people like to come and see how these things grow. When they come to see it, they can also buy things from there. They can, you know, pay money to enter these places. So by growing this kind of, you know, keeping such kind of places, not only we foster or we encourage tourism, but money to grow more and more or to invest more and more into agriculture. Mango, chiku, guava, coconut, custard apple and some regional fruit trees can be grown in these places. In agri-tourism, shade giving local or exotic attractive plants could be grown. Now, in this kind of a tourism, you know, where we are calling people, come see our botanical gardens, come see our rare plants or come see the spices that we have grown. We can grow big plants so that, you know, there is shade, attractive exotic plants. Those are plants which you get from outside. They are not local to our place. Local plants are the plants grown in our area, but something which comes from abroad or something that comes from some other state are called exotic plants. Ornamental and flowering plants, something that looks good, you know, something that is rare, can be grown and people will come to see. Okay, a butterfly garden could be set up in such type of places. Okay, also they could have a medicinal plants or garden section containing organic vegetables and fruits. So many things can be done to encourage people to come and see. And when people come and see, they also want to buy things because they visit there, and so they, you know, the people who are doing this agri-tourism can sell small plantlets, seedlings, the fruits and vegetables grown there, and therefore agri-tourism now becomes a very important occupation, which gives a lot of money. Agro-complementary occupations. Now, agro-complementary means those occupations that are related to agriculture. The first being animal husbandry. In animal husbandry in India, it is practiced for milk production and for using cattle in farming operations. For example, cows and buffaloes are raised for milk and bulls and male buffaloes for heavy work. Local Indian variety of cows like Sahiwal, Sindhi, Gir, Devni, Dangi, etc. and exotic meaning coming from out, like Jersey or this Holstein, Brown Swiss, etc. are kept for milk in animal husbandry. Now, to do animal husbandry properly, you have to take proper care of cattle. To get a high yield of milk, a balanced diet containing all nutrients must be provided to cattle. Now, this balanced diet for cattle must include fiber-rich coarse food, very rough kind of food, fodder and sufficient water. And this is how cattle are fed. The cattle shed must be clean, it should be dry, proper ventilation means there should be proper air passing through it and should have a roof. Cattle should be regularly vaccinated to see that they are disease free because they live close to each other, and if one of them get a disease, it will be transmitted to all. Therefore, they should be regularly vaccinated. Next agro-complementary occupation is poultry farming. Rearing of egg and meat yielding chickens is called poultry farming. So this is a typical poultry farm. New hybrid varieties are developed. They cross Indian varieties like Asil and exotic varieties like Leghorn. The objectives of hybridizing or you know uniting two different types of breeds are to produce good quality chickens in large numbers, to develop the ability of these chickens to withstand high temperature, and to use the byproducts of agriculture as the poultry feed. So this is the Indian chicken, Asil, sometimes hybridized with the Leghorn, that is an exotic variety. So you see, chickens are of two types, layers and broilers. Those raised for eggs are called layers. Those raised only to be eaten or for their meat are broilers. Now, those raised for eggs are the Leghorn, Minorca, Ancona, Layman, etc. Those raised for meat, Brahma, Long, Cochin or the Asil. Sericulture, another agro-complementary occupation. Silkworms are reared for production of silk. And the very common one is the Bombyx mori. There are four stages in the life cycle of a silkworm, that is egg, larva, pupa and adult. Now, thousands of eggs are deposited by the female moth, are incubated artificially. So those eggs are taken, they are put in an incubator which has a nice temperature, a regulated temperature, and they put them there so that they can, you know, hatch faster. Larvae hatching out of the eggs are deposited on the leaves of the mulberry plant. Now these larvae, they eat continuously for 3 or 4 days, and after feeding off the leaves of the mulberry tree, they move on to the branches of the mulberry tree. Now silk thread is formed from the secretion of their salivary glands. Now when they move to the branches, they start secreting something from their saliva, and that forms silk thread. Larvae spin this thread around themselves and they form a cocoon. They cover themselves, which is the spherical in shape. That means it's, you know, fully covered. It's all around them. So you can see this is the cocoon now of the silkworm. 10 days before, you know, the cocoon can hatch, which is now cocoon called the pupa. Before it can hatch and that the adult moth or the butterfly can come out, these cocoons are collected, they are transferred into boiling water, and you know that pupa will die there, but they get the silk. This is the cocoon, okay, and the silk thread after being put in boiling water. So the pupa dies and the silk fibers in the cocoon, they become loose by putting it in boiling water. These fibers are unwound, slowly taken out, they are processed and they are put on reels. You see, different colors, they are put on reels. Then various kinds of fabric, that is cloth, is woven from the silk thread and you get a beautiful silk cloth. So here we can see biotechnology helping human beings in so many different areas.